Okay. Episode, I don't know, maybe four of Haute Cocoa Critics. Fa la 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 la. Yay. Okay. Tonight I have on, well, you know who I am. I'm Charlene Char, your host, the person. But I have two funny, hot, smart comedians with me tonight. And I have DDT. Beow, beow, beow.
Hello.
Whoop, 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 whoop. And I have Lady Grace Morton hailing from Houston Shire.
San
Where are you?
Antonio.
Oh, San Antonio Shire.
San Antonio. Okay. I lived there for three terrible months. No.
I worked there for three terrible years.
Oh,
I've been here for
wow.
almost 3 years, so it's a lot.
Yeah.
Oh. When I first was, so I would go there for business and I would be there like 3 nights in a row or whatever. And I stayed at this like Marriott. It looked nice. It was a big building. All the rooms were on the inside instead of like outside entry. And I picked it because it's on 410 or whatever, West 410. I picked it because coming from Houston off of I-10, it was like one of the first hotels that was a Marriott. Until like my third visit, when I realized that it actually wasn't in a safe place, but it was near where I needed to be. And how I figured it out was I checked into a room that was definitely like somebody died in there.
Like was killed or died?
I think they were killed because the door was like pried open.
Oh my.
The carpet
Not
like in front of the
murder.
door was like ruffled, like
Scruffed up.
thank you, scarfed up. And then when I opened the door, and this is the best part, besides the super heavy evil air that lingered when I opened the door, there, you know, they have those like off-white curtain shears. It was like light stains, like all they did was just take some shout and keep it moving. And then what confirmed it was when I went back down to the front desk and I said, hey, can you change my room? Because I think somebody was murdered in there. And they go, what room was it?
No, Lord. Because there have been multiple murders in
There's
multiple rooms, y'all.
there's not an
You got to
immediate
be
no, the
more
reason still
specific.
here.
You know,
Wait.
we have a lot of people have died here. Be more specific.
I mean, it's a
But
Tuesday. What do you want?
that's San Antonio though, because when you were saying that, I Googled it on the side just to be sure. And we do have several haunted hotels, and they're not like, oh yeah, this is the haunted hotel, blah blah blah. It'll be like a Marriott or like a Holiday Inn or something. And they're like, oh yeah, this used to be, there's one downtown that was like used to be a prison, and one is was one of the last public execution prisons in the United States. Yeah. And now it's a Holiday Inn Express.
Wow.
I bet it is because there were executions.
You gotta love
Yeah.
urban
Pinky
development, man. You
Express.
gotta Indian burial grounds, now
God.
an Applebee's or whatever the fuck.
It's bad. You
Yeah.
don't think you can build up a bunch of restaurants around the Alamo and not have haunted shit? It's the Alamo.
Yeah. And
Oh,
then they were a
yeah.
lot of drunks, so they're drunk and dead. They're just staggering
Surely.
around, not knowing what to do.
Little drunky skeleton ghosty things with
Right, when
big hats.
I can only imagine a drunk day, Sam boy. Like I feel like that's a sight to see.
I know.
Haunting the fuck out of somebody.
And in case anybody is watching this and they pick up on a specific what do we say, velvety texture to DDT's voice, she hails from the land of Louisiana.
Do we say it
Louisiana.
like that?
Yeah.
Yes, I am from Louisiana. The bottom of it, in fact, the real Louisiana is what we tend to call it, but south of I-10. So.
Yeah, south of I-10. Here's the thing, ladies. Y'all are really good at history, so this movie that we're gonna review tonight, it made me a little nervous because hot, I mean, y'all can tell, like you can see them, they're gorgeous, but the big brains on these broads, like woo chow. I've been on podcasts with one, and I've seen DDT stand up And this is an old movie we've picked tonight, hence my vintage cardigan.
I like
circa
it.
Very classy. 19-
Thank you.
I like it.
It was my mother's. It is my mother. She's alive. I'm just wearing.
you're just holding it now.
Just kept it from her.
My voice lowered like there was some information I needed to share.
I feel like it was my mother's.
She left it to me in.
Yeah. There's a story behind it. Don't ask.
Don't ask. It's never been washed. That's all you need to know. Because of the stones, the little rhinestones. We don't want the rhinestones to fall out. But this is a much older movie than the ones we're currently reviewing from like the 2023s. But it's a classic.
Mm-hmm.
And we're gonna get into it in a second, but I have a question. Before we got going, I flossed my. Now, first of all, this is actually not a Stanley. And Grace has informed me that this is the final key for her in particular into being, mm-hmm. what was it called again? A what?
A basic white girl.
Okay, the basic white girl. Now, first of all, these Stanleys, right? This is actually not a Stanley. Now, my story is so white. Per my mug, per the cardigan, per the jewelry, per the blonde hair that I have right now. Oh, I know the lingo. Mm-hmm. This is actually a Mary Square.
Okay.
And speaking of white, I got it in Charleston.
I have no idea what a Mary Square is, but I know what a Charleston is.
So apparently this is like the fancy brand of Stanley. Mm-hmm. This is the Charleston's bougie Stanley, I guess.
It's better than a Stanley, yeah.
Well, that was the only way I was going to carry like this thermos with a handle.
Yeah.
It had to have animal print or something. I wonder.
No idea what a Stanley is. I have no idea what you people are talking about.
It's like a travel. Continue. Do you want me to go get mine? Hang on.
Everybody's got a Stanley except for me, but
I'll show you mine.
No idea what this is that you're speaking of.
Oh yeah. It is like.
So is it like a Yeti cup? Like
is that what the Yeti? It is stomping the Yeti out of existence.
Stomping the Yeti. Okay.
Oof. This is it. They come in all kinds of different colors and designs and stuff. And you're right, because every like 4 years, we recycle what the trendy vessel for carrying liquids is going to be.
Yeah.
For a while, it was a Yeti. For a little while, it was that other one that made a lot of noise, and I can't remember what it was called. It was really trendy when I was in college. It was like a thirst something.
I have what is called a brewmate. Apparently, it's fancy.
Yeah, that is fancy.
There you go.
Apparently, the girls enjoy. This was a present from my cousin. I don't know no difference. I just drank stuff out of it. That's what I know.
It actually is a signal of wealth. So be careful.
Well, good.
Don't take that just anywhere. Yeah, don't take that just anywhere. Mm. Don't leave it in your car. A hydro flask.
That was hydro trendy flask. For a while.
Okay. With all the stickers. You put all the stickers all over it.
Mm-hmm. But now like it's all about the Stanley.
Yeah, I'm like, if I'm not hiking, what do I need a hydro flask?
Yeah, I know. That sounds very like technologically advanced. It sounds like a survival tool.
All the Stanleys have different names. And this one is specifically called like the 40 ounce like hydro. It's like the 40 ounce hydro quencher or something. Like it has a very fancy name as if it was an engine.
Is it good for hangovers then? Like hydro?
Right.
No, it's just a big jug with a handle.
I mean, if you run out of gas in your car, can you ride it the rest of the way? Like, I'm just so confused.
But here's the thing. Because I was super anti-Stanley for a long time. Because I was like, this is dumb and it's trendy. And I already have all of the other white girl things. I don't need all the Infinity Stones. But then... this woman was in a car accident and her car caught on fire and she went back the next day to collect her belongings from like wherever they towed it to, and her Stanley was inside untouched and the ice was still cold inside.
Yeah, that's a commercial.
Why didn't they Why don't they make the car out of the cup? This seems like a this is something that like Dodge and them should get on right now.
Well, the lady posted it on TikTok, and Stanley, like the CEO of Stanley, saw it, and they bought her a new car.
Okay, yes, well then why don't they make townhouses out of Stanley? Anyway,
there. You know why don't they? Why don't they?
Another story for another day. But this episode of Hot Cocoa Critics is sponsored by Stanley and Madison Square, Stanley's hotter younger sister.
There you go.
Yeah. Wow, Grace.
Well, it's like drinks.
You know, I look, Deanna, DDT. I have a question for you.
Okay.
What would you say is an unapologetically Black girl equivalent at Starbucks, coffee-wise, drink-wise? Do you feel like there is one?
Look, as a person who did work at Starbucks for like a good 6 months, maybe, before I got fired, I could say I did not see a lot of Black women in there, period. But I think the Black girls are into the pumpkin spice. I think that's like our jam, too, from what I can tell.
Okay.
I mean, my auntie, I know somebody like me, the farthest I'll go is a macchiato, like a caramel macchiato. That's the deepest I'll go into.
Yeah.
But you know what Black girls like? They like a frappuccino. Black girls, a frappuccino.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
That's what they want. Like a nice caramel frap. Caramel frap. Yeah.
Need to cool down because their wigs are hot. And like, you know.
But yeah, you can catch a Black girl with a nice frappuccino vibe, like a nice little frappuccino judge.
Yeah.
Just frappuccino in general, or is there like a specific flavor?
I think in general, I mean, they love the caramel. I really feel like the Black girls love a caramel. The salted caramel is one. Mm-hmm. But you know, they make so many different frappuccinos. I used to be a green tea frapp girl myself.
Oh yes.
Back in the day, I was a green tea frapp girl. A mocha. Mm-hmm. You know, a mocha frapp, the girls love a mocha frappuccino.
Now that's what got me started was the mocha frappuccino. And I would get it every other Friday on Payday Friday because obvi.
Yep.
Price point.
Right. Get that venti. You got to get that venti because
I
got
like hooked on it. And then, like, you know, the holidays came or winter came. And I was like, now it's cold. What am I going to drink? And then they were like, oh, we have a peppermint mocha latte for you. And I was like, And then
also a jam.
As somebody who has brought taken coffee orders for meetings and such, I will say that the Black ladies in attendance at these meetings, when it comes to a frap, they love the salted caramel. They
salted caramel goes in.
That chocolate ribbon crunch, cocoa crunch, cookie crunch.
We like texture. See, Black women like texture. We like to get a little, you know. A little something crunchy in it. Yeah. Right. We like a little crunch in it.
We like a little snack and a beverage. We're busy.
Right. Right. We gotta do both.
And then cinnamon dolces.
That leads me to an important question that I love to ask people. Mm-hmm. Do you take your orange juice with pulp or no pulp?
With pulp.
Same.
Do you chew your
juice? I take it any kind of way. I just love orange juice. But
pulp is not a deal breaker for me.
Absolutely not. Absolutely not.
Even in the mimosa.
Some drinks can have the little crunch, but some cannot.
I mean, but pulp isn't a crunch. It's more like it just kind of slides down your throat with all the juice. It doesn't crunch.
You literally took the words out of my mouth. Yeah.
It's just, you know, just slides down in there.
She's softer than the celery thing. Like, the strains. You know.
Right. It's just, it's very subtle. It really doesn't get in the way. You know it's there, but it's not very abrasive.
You know, Grace, if you want to determine one's level of, like, I don't know, how do you say this? Like a refined palate, ask them how they feel about tapioca teas with the beads. Are you able to drink? Deanna, stop. Are you able to? Are you able to drink?
You able?
Are you able to drink your drink and manage the gummy bear thingies at the bottom?
Never. I never had it, so I don't know.
Like I've see those little balls. Like the boba tea, like I see
those little balls.
Yeah, that's yeah, yeah, that's that. It's yeah, the same the thing. Boba tapiocas. Those are tapioca balls, is what they are.
Oh, okay. I've always just known them as like boba balls, but we don't. This is another thing about white girls. We find things that have already existed and we rename it as if it's brand new.
Mm-hmm. I thought boba tea, I thought that was like the Eastern name for it. Like, isn't like it an Eastern thing? Like a like an Asian beverage, and boba is what they call it over there.
Yeah. Yeah. They, yes. They have these tea house chains around here and they just.
Right.
Yeah. It's true. White girls do that. Like, we have something called cornrows. It's a hairstyle. Y'all have somehow renamed them boxer braids because that's what boxers, girl boxers wear their hair in.
Yeah. I remember when that was first a trend when I was like, I think it was in high school because I'd never heard of it until the Kardashians started doing it. And I just saying, are the Kardashians not white? And people were like, well, they're part Armenian. And I was like, that's
well, the code
white.
There
Eastern
is.
European.
Eastern European, Western Europeans, the white Europeans don't like them because of their slightly brown skin. So that makes them the black people of Europe.
Oh, boy.
Oh, that justifies all of it then. Oh, well, then their butts are real and it's fine.
Yeah, all the stains, the like they don't fuck with the stains. Yeah. They're white.
The Kendall and white. Kylie are fully white.
Yeah. They're white.
Well, yeah, they're half Armenian, I guess.
Well, no, they're not. They're not Armenian
the
at all.
Three are. The old three are.
Wait, is Kris Jenner not Armenian?
No.
Kris is white. Kris is from like Ohio.
Yeah, she's white.
Yeah.
She's not Armenian?
No. Mm-mm. No, it's their dad.
That's it.
Yeah.
Yeah, just Robert.
Just Rob.
Just Robert. Wow. Okay. Also, I just want to, I do want to make a public service announcement that Black girls also made silk pillowcases a thing like 40 years ago. So the fact that I see TikToks on it and
also
I,
slathering Vaseline on your face.
Also.
So many things.
So many things. Look, ahead of Black History Month, here we are. Like,
let's do it.
Let's do it. Yeah, so, you know, speaking of the white theme, apparently, that we've delved into, let's talk about the movie that the three of us have watched and beloved, White Christmas.
I love it so much.
That is what we call Christmas at my parents' house, yeah. Christmas at the Mortons, White Christmas, it's all the same thing.
But my mother, like, those are all her favorite Christmas movie. Like, she made us watch It's a Wonderful Life on Thanksgiving.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, she's really, really, Miracle on 34th Street, like, the old black and white joint.
Yeah.
Like, she's really into them. Yeah, she's really into them. So, White Christmas is her favorite of those. And so, it's kind of, like, my favorite, too.
I mean, a lot of the Christmas classics, though, were, like, they all were. Like, you had the two you just named, plus A Christmas Story. We just weren't accustomed to seeing us on TV at Christmas, or hardly ever. Right. And then it grew and grew and grew, and then there became other classics that feature Black families. But White Christmas is really the backdrop, I would say, of Christmas. Like, it kind of...
Absolutely.
Right? Don't y'all think?
Yeah,
it feels the most Christmassy and cheery, and like, you know, because like It's a Wonderful Life and Miracle on 34th Street and The Bishop's Wife, they kind of have like some sad elements
they
to
take
them.
You down to bring you up.
right But White Christmas is just like, oh, this is a happy time. You know, they're on a train and stuff. It's so
it has
cute.
A slight warning about global warming that I didn't pick up on as a child. And then when I watched it, and they were like, oh my gosh, snow. And then they get to Vermont, and there's no snow. And I was like, oh, it's today.
Don't know.
You know what? I related to that so hard. Wait, let's walk it back. Yeah. Okay. So for those of you who don't even know what we're talking about, and feel free to jump in if I forget any names, because you know I'm going to mess it up.
Bing Crosby, Dan McKay, mm-hmm. Rosemary Clooney.
Go for it, girl.
And what's that other girl named? The real skinny one with the legs. I forget her.
I know. I have the notes on her.
I forget her name.
I know. She plays Judy, which then makes me wonder when they, like, one phrase is like old phrase, when a man was gay,
Vera but
was
still
kind of in the closet. He would say, I'm a friend of Judy. And I always thought it was Judy Garland. But then after watching this movie, I don't Vera know. Because there's some very, like, there's a lot of, like,
homoerotic undertones.
Oh, just like straight up, like, I.
That's every musical from Metro Goldwyn Mayer. Okay.
True.
It's all lots of homoerotic.
Yeah, it was. Like, Some Like It Hot was a nice one. Singing in the Rain. Like, awesome. Though, yeah, all of those. Yeah.
Because, yeah, this came out in 1954. Mm-hmm. And what is her? Okay.
Vera-Ellen.
Thank you, Vera-Ellen. Yeah. So
lovely lady.
Oh my gosh. And she was just the tiniest thing and danced and danced and danced and never stopped dancing.
Like, girl, what waist? Come on. What waist?
And her little ponytail, I loved it so much with like the fluff. And then I was like, I want to wear my hair like that tomorrow.
You know, it was just a cutie pie. She really was.
She was such a cutie pie. And so she was paired up with, is that Danny Kaye? Who she was like, okay. So he was the one that was basically like saying to Bing at one point, I need you to settle down and get married and have a bunch of kids so I can go get a massage. And I was like,
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Danny Kaye, great comedian. Yes. Great American comedian.
I will say, as much as that is a weird sexist thing to say, I do have some friends that I'm like, I wish you would go find somebody and get out of my house.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. So I can.
I will admit to being that toxic friend that has been like, please go meet a girl. Please go away.
Why not? So I can finally put the bed back in the couch and then use the couch instead of the fold out part. Always just a jar. It's always a jar. Yeah.
Right, so you can finally deflate that air mattress that's been in my basement. You know?
Thank you. Okay, so what war? This is the part that I missed. So this movie like starts in like the backdrop of like World War II. Oh, I guessed it right in my notes. I just guessed. And then that's how Wallace and Phil meet. Mm-hmm. But Wallace is like higher ranking. He's like a lieutenant or something.
Mm-hmm.
And then the general retires. He goes away. That's important because mm-hmm. you might miss it if you're not paying attention. That's actually important that the general goes away and retires, which you see it, but you don't know what the significance of it is yet. And then Danny Kaye, the one you were talking about, the amazing comedian, talks Bing Crosby. I'm just going to use their names. into allowing him to be a part of his act because Bing got drafted like a lot of performers and just men period in the 50s would get drafted. Like, they didn't give a damn like what you did for a living. There's a war on and we need our men, come one, come all, and then they all get drafted.
Uncle Sam wants you. Also homoerotica.
that's true. So why don't you have a good time with the boys, come on over. I love the homoeroticism of World War II. It was cute. It was really cute. Like snapping each other with towels. Right, you know?
Yeah.
So you're in a foxhole. You're in a foxhole with your boys. And the way they bonded, like after they came home, you could tell like they made out a little. Like you could tell.
Yeah.
Something happened in that foxhole.
My grandpa served and he wanted his oldest son named after his absolute best friend from the military, but not his real legal name. His nickname was Lacey.
Oh, that's so cute.
But let's think for a second. Was my grandpa having a homoerotic experience with Lacey?
I mean, it's possible. Yeah. I mean, sometimes you just need somebody to hold you. And sometimes, you know, that person probably has a dick as well. And you know. What are you going to do in those circumstances?
What are you going to do? I mean, also, if we remember that scene from Pulp Fiction, Grace, have you seen Pulp Fiction? There's a scene with, of course his name is going to escape me right now.
John Travolta?
No, the guy.
Bruce Willis?
No, the sarcastic guy, the guy that went to the war and brings the watch back for Bruce Willis from his grandfather, where he talks about where the watch had been and how it was up his ass for, like, he put the watch, like, up his ass for, like, 48 days or something. Why is his name Chris something?
I haven't seen this movie since the early 2000s, so.
No, that's perfectly fine. I used to say it was a favorite of mine, but, like, now, if I can't even think of the guy's name, it's okay. So, I'm pulling him up now, because it's going to kill me, because I always forget, and that's sad. Christopher Walken. Oh, I did say
Christopher Walken. How I forget that he was in that movie. I don't know. There are so many people in that movie.
There was one of those, like, very... If you've not... Pulp Fiction is definitely a must-see because there's just so many one-liners and references that the old people at your job will use. So, go for it.
Absolutely.
The war ends and they leave, or they're discharged. Do they leave or they're discharged?
I think the war's just over.
The war's just
over. Yeah, they kill everybody. D-Day? That's what happens.
Yeah. So then all they do is they just finally get to the dancing. They just get to the damn dancing. So you blink and they're on stage and they're doing, like, the bop, 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 the duet. So obviously he talked them into it and it worked. And then it just shows, like, how successful they've become, and they're going on tour all over the country and doing all this stuff. And then they introduce the Hayes sisters.
Mm-hmm.
In their beautiful dresses. Sisters. This is a
sisters. Umbrella. You know,
with their fans.
I have an umbrella here.
Yeah, with their feather fans.
Oh yeah, it was a fan.
I used to love those fans. Like, they were the cutest thing to me. I was like, I want one. I need
my sisters and I got blue tissue paper and paper plates and did the whole little in, like, third grade, and we were like,
that is so cute.
That's super cute.
Because I love those outfits. Like, I love, like, their costume and design and everything. It was just so beautiful.
I love 50s costume designs. Oh my gosh.
They put their back into it. They was not fucking around back then.
They were not fucking around.
We need costumes. We're not playing. Somebody get Bob Mackie on the phone. We need gowns. We need sequins. We need rhinestones.
We need petticoats.
We need chiffon. We need silk. We need set.
And then, did I say chiffon? We need chiffon.
Lots of chiffon.
We need a ruffles. Belt. We need cinchers.
We need sequins. We need feathers.
We need so many corsets. We need so many boots.
Jewels. We need jewels.
We need feathers. Ostrich. Peacock.
Bring your mom's cardigan.
Bring your mom's cardigan. Because then we're gonna throw a cardigan over all of it. That seems to be what they all did, right?
They would have these outfits and then have the little, like, jacket. It was super cute.
Just like,
my problem was, what used to get on my goddamn nerves, bitch, put your arms in it. Like, just put your, you will be much warmer.
And that has come back.
If you would just put your arms in that doggone cardigan, what are you playing around for? Are you cold or not?
Look, here we go. I'm leaving.
No, just the tops of their shoulders.
I've never gotten up.
In that one button. The tops, just the one button.
Are you doing a wardrobe change?
No.
Okay. No, I like it.
Okay. She's just demonstrating what?
The shawl.
Well, this has sleeves. It's a...
Yeah.
It's my ugly sweater. Yeah, I'm just wearing it like... Yeah. I can't...
Like, I feel like you should be on a postage stamp.
You really should. You look like you have your hands folded very pleasantly on your lap, like that. Just the
What is my contribution to society, though?
This.
I mean, your presence.
Yeah. Okay.
This. You're a philanthropist. You're a philanthropist. That's what you are. You're a philanthropist.
I'm looking into the horizon.
You're a socialite. You know, that's what it. What it's giving.
I'm sweating. Okay. Well, and that's what they did, and then. Until that one scene where our girl, y'all said her name earlier, Julie. What's her real name?
Rosemary Clooney? The one who lost it?
The skinny one?
Oh, Vera Ellen.
No, Rosemary Clooney is the other one.
Vera Ellen.
Yeah.
When she wore that, like, very, which has also been reinvented now. Yeah, the little leotard outfit during the, like, super 60s cute mod dance thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Where she does all the flips.
Yes. Yeah. It's, what do they call it? Theater? It was a theater piece?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Now,
I watched the... I had to go back and rewatch it because I watched White Christmas a lot as a child. Mm-hmm. And I didn't remember. I was like, I know there's going to be things in here, but I don't remember what it is. So I watched it with one of my friends whose roommate is a like valet dancer. And ooh, Vera Ellen was, I didn't know this, apparently a super accomplished ballerina and is iconic for people who do ballet. And I'm not one of those people. But apparently she had like a horrendous eating disorder most of her life because they were always just like skinnier.
She was really small in the waist. Like she was super small in the waist. Like
tiny. I will say that this whole plot for me was just all to get them to the lodge to re-sing the same songs. I counted, they sang four times. Wasn't always performed by the Hayes sisters, as we know, because there was a little lightly done drag moment.
Drag moments.
Yeah. Yeah, they did the little, because they always did drag back in the day. They loved camp. They loved the little vaudeville. It was
that was Bing Crosby's idea. It wasn't initially in the script for he and Danny Kaye to put on the outfits, but they were just digging around on set all the time. And he was like, I want to do this. I think we should do it.
It'll be cute. It'll be camp.
Yeah. And it was. And it was iconic. It was adorable.
It was.
It was back when men were men.
Make America gay again.
Make men go camping together in war zones again. Well,
thank you.
You know?
Well, what they did was they like literally did that so the women could escape having to pay. What was it? Get paid or pay? I don't remember. The evil club boss guy. They did it to help them get away.
Oh, yeah. I thought you meant like historically they put men in war.
Yeah, I was about to say, what are you talking about?
And I was like,
and I said, that's a great idea. If that's not what's happening, they should do it again.
They should. Yes.
They should try it.
And that's how I ended up on the stamp. I came up with that idea and saved the world. That's why I'm on the stamp. Next to Harry
to war. So they'll leave us alone.
So we can get some rest, damn it. yeah. No, I thought it was... And I will say this, it held up to the name White Christmas. I didn't see not one Black person in that entire film. Not even as like an extra.
As the help. They used to have us in the background as the help. I really didn't see that either.
I was like, I don't see a mammy anywhere. I don't see nothing. I don't see anybody. Right. Yeah. It was
like
just,
one of my favorite movies, Cat on a Hot Tin Roof. You just see us as like, you know, fixing shit. So hey, not even a White Christmas, because they meant that. They meant that,
and the general who now owned the inn that this big Christmas extravaganza takes place in to save the inn, I'm sure, or whatever, it's in great repair, apparently, and he doesn't need to have any Black people around fixing things. Like, he's got it all under control. And the thing that I didn't remember that hit me this time was, I never did understand how they got all those soldiers like at the end, like singing and greeting the general at all. I did think
the broadcast, remember?
Yeah. Well, now, they put it on the radio or something.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I did laugh my ass off when Danny Kaye was like trying to keep him from watching or listening to the radio and he pretended to be injured. Like the best physical comedian ever. Like, what in the heck? What in the heck? Like, I was amazed. But I did pick up on something. That song, like, what is a general when he doesn't have an army? Or
when he has, like, no army?
when he has no army and when he's retired.
Yeah, something like that.
That kind of touched on like mental health even back then a little bit. Like I was kind of impressed by the sentiment of that song. And one fun fact.
It was cute how they got behind him, you know? It was cute how they rallied for the old man, you know what I'm saying? Because I know he felt useless as an elder, you know? You have a failing inn or hotel situation, but you're too proud to ask because you don't want to look as weak as you feel. It's just very sad.
And he was so handsome. Can we agree? He was like...
Yeah, he was a cute old dude.
I did notice, and this is a fun fact, and this is a part of it, and I've got to tell y'all this. Part of the whole Haute Cocoa Critics sphere is that we do give a score at the end, like what we think the movie it should score, like on a 5-star scoring system, but it's instead peppermint hot chocolates is the scoring system. And so like plot, theme, and in this particular movie topic, nostalgia. Does it give you the feels all over again? And costume design, hair, glam, all of it. And just like, you give it your score. And then we tally it up for an average, since there are three of us. And then we give it like a hard score. And one thing I did notice was as he was walking, so I'm going back to hair, because we talked about that a little bit earlier. When he was walking down that little walkway to greet like all of his soldiers, and he was like having the moment, that was a toupee he had on.
Mm-hmm.
It was a really good toupee. You could see the lace.
Yeah, the lace was there, baby. The lace was there.
Well, I mean, in this world of HD, the fact that it took me, now I may or may not have had like a white Russian in my hand when I was watching it. The drink, not the man.
You have to. It's like Christmas.
Right.
Gotta have a little drinky drink.
You gotta have a little drinky drink. Yeah.
Yeah.
And also, it's like the movie that you decorate the Christmas tree to. You start decorating.
Yeah. Right? Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And it's a 2-hour film, and it flew by. I must say that as well.
Well, I mean,
it's like all the musical numbers.
You have like 9-minute songs. Yeah.
Right, it's all the musical numbers and stuff, and they were very engaging. It was a lot of dance, and it was like,
I felt like a baby watching razzle dazzle fruit videos.
Yeah,
right. It's just a lot of razzle dazzle.
What do you think about the other girl, the sister,
Rosemary Clooney, the great Rosemary Clooney? Come on, man. A shame what happened to her. But
what happened to her? Okay,
she lost her goddamn mind.
I didn't know
she went like crazy. In her life? Yeah. Absolutely. I forget why. I don't know if they lobotomized her or what, but she lost it.
Is she related to George at all?
Are you thinking of Rosemary Kennedy?
Rosemary Clooney was
lobotomized.
She was lobotomized, but I feel like Rosemary Clooney.
Google says she had lung cancer.
That's what it was. It was something very tragic that happened to her. But yes, Rosemary Kennedy was the cancer. But I feel like she is
different. A lobotomy.
I think she's also George Clooney's aunt.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Definitely related. What does the wiki say?
What does the wiki say?
She had a tumultuous childhood. There.
Okay. Yeah, she was bipolar. That's what it was. She did lose it. She had the bipolar disorder, and back then, you know, they didn't know what to do about it.
And they just call it like mania or something back then.
Right.
It's called a long vacation at the seaside.
Right. Like I know she had like mental health issues. So, you know, that was hard back then when they just thought women were crazy in general by nature because we were evil.
Oh, gosh. You know what? But also, we got a couch out of it. They now have a fainting couch.
They just hooked us up to a vibrator all day in the sanitarium and hope for the best. So
she was, I didn't know this. She was really addicted to alcohol and pills, which every starlet was, but she was part of the campaign in the Democratic Party for Robert Kennedy. And she was at the Ambassador Hotel when Robert Kennedy was assassinated, only a few feet away from where he was shot. And she had a complete nervous breakdown over it.
And there we have it.
Yikes.
Yikes.
Yep. She had a rough time.
But before that, she had a great career.
She did. She was highly respected, great singer.
She didn't get to eat a sandwich on set, but
no. And she was also thin. None of those women did. She was also thin. She was like a taller, mm-hmm. sturdier lady, but she was, that's how thin the other one was.
Do you think they were just like walking around if they saw him trying to sneak and eat something, they would just slap it out their hands? Ta-da! You dumb broad.
Put down the veggie.
I heard they put them on a lot of stuff to make them not hungry.
Cocaine. Well, and of course it makes you not hungry. Like, because they both, look, back then everybody still wore like strong foundation. They were snatched down. Like, it was like not the.
And you could tell they were in them. You could tell.
They were in them. You could tell. Mm-hmm. And that makes you not like hungry. Bees. I mean, as somebody who has worn a waist trainer many times and worn corsets and worn tight like formal dresses with like stuff in them, once you're in it, you really aren't hungry because there's no blood flowing to your stomach anyway, and the minute you take it off, you feel like super coke bottle-y and hot as all get out, just fine as wine for about 10 minutes, and then all of a sudden everything settles and your stomach's like, feed me, and then it's like, oh, I want to eat everything. And that's kind of
because your rib cage needs time to readjust to being normal, and make room for your intestinal tract. Make room for your lungs and shit.
Because the lungs move the blood, which sends all the messages everywhere.
And now we're regular.
Yeah, ooh. yeah. It's. I mean, I've done it, and I will tell you, while the results are nice, you also just don't get hungry until that sucker comes off. And then...
And it destroys your actual internal organs if you wear them too long.
That's true.
Yeah, it's super bad for you.
Yeah. Well, I'm fine now, thanks. actually, what stopped it was I went to my doctor. This was like 6 or 7 years ago. This was like when they first came back and they were like all the rage. I went to my doctor and I was like, hey... I'm just having like really, I have asthma anyway, but I was like, I'm having like some shortness of breath. And we ran through like this long list of things. And it was like, no. She was like, environmental changes. I was like, no. And she's like, do you smoke now? I was like, no. And so we just kept going. And then she finally goes, I don't know what it could be. And I think I did one of these and I realized I had on my waist trainer. I'd go, oh, well, I do wear a waist trainer like 9 hours a day. And she goes, that's why you can't breathe.
Please stop that.
You're wearing a corset.
But that was all during the time where I was driving to San Antonio a bunch. And oddly enough, it helped with my back, like back pain on like long drives. Like,
yeah, it will keep your spine like.
Yeah.
Like, nice and taut.
Yes. So. Whatever. Okay.
No slouching in a waist trainer.
No, none. And look, you can tell the people that overdo it. You can tell also now that I don't wear one. It's very obvious. So favorite moments of the movie before we start giving scores.
One is when Danny Kaye does like his little comedy thing, like his little comedy routine thing with the jokes, and he talks about the dog and everything. Like, it, I just love Danny Kaye. I just love everything.
What else has he been in?
I do. Oh, and Rosemary Clooney when she sang that song in that black dress. I like that one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I love that one. But I think my favorite part is when they're on the train. When they were on the train, I think that's my favorite part. Yeah. It's so cute. It's Christmas.
I love it. What about you, Grace?
I think also kind of everything that Danny Kaye does in this movie is my favorite part. But I specifically really like the part at the very end with the Christmas tree and they open the doors and I'm like, oh my God.
So, yeah, that was beautiful. With the snow.
And Danny Kaye is like trying to talk to Bing Crosby, and he's already kissing Rosemary Clooney. I don't know any of these character names, but he's also kissing Rosemary Clooney, and he's like, "Oh, hang on a second, I'll join you." And then turns. That is homies. That is homie shit. You're like, oh, he's, let me do that too.
Let me kill those my men who had sleepovers. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. Did you notice in that moment though, he unwraps this horse
mm-hmm.
and does nothing with it. It looked like he was going to put it on the tree, but then he just like puts it down. Like it was almost like a weird, either missed moment, or it may even have significance. Like maybe that was like in memory of someone. She told him
when they had met up, when she did, after she did song in the Love You Did Me Wrong and she had the velvet dress.
Oh,
she
yeah.
said something to the degree of like, it's really hard when your knight in shining armor falls off of his horse. Something like that. Okay. And he was like, well, if you ever think of a way that I can get back on that horse, let me know. Like something like that.
Okay. Oh, so it was like a reference to the horse. Got you.
Yeah. It wasn't because he's a horse girl. Yeah.
Got you.
This is for like the super fans then. Okay. Okay.
Right.
Hmm. I watched it a lot as a child.
No, that's okay. Look. It was your idea to cover this movie, and I said, let's do it, because I hadn't watched it in a while. It is a classic. I love the Technicolor. I love how, like, bright all the colors are, like, of the costumes, and I love the end as well. Like, just, it's all so bright, especially when they bring all those kids on stage, and they have the trees, and then the set moves like that. Like, I'm just here for all the theatrics. There is one little girl. Of all the little girls who looks, she keeps looking around. Everybody else knows like where to look. And there's this one little girl that just keeps going like. And every time I watch that movie, I do look for that little girl. Cause she's like, I'm here.
She's like, I'm four. Jeez.
Like, and they're swaying one way and she's swaying the other. And I'm like, I'm here for this little girl. That would literally be me. Like, okay, we've been in one movie and we're not putting you in anymore. Thanks. But I don't know. Like, I just, if I had a favorite, I just loved all the thinly veiled gay references with Danny Kaye, that he was like, so not. And it was almost like he and Julie, or whatever her real name is, had like an understanding. Like, I know you're not into me. I know I'm not. It's like, it was so like, aw shucks, and like, you know? That was my favorite chemistry of everybody. But I think my favorite part, gosh, you both said them really, like between the end and the train. I just love that. I just love them singing, all four of them. Anytime all four of them sang together, right. I just loved it. And the rehearsals, what I thought was really clever, I do want to bring this up. I thought it was really clever the way all the rehearsals were basically dance numbers, because they were rehearsing, but they were full, like, dress out dance number, or what do you call them? Full costume.
Dress rehearsal.
Exactly, Grace. Dress rehearsal. I had a brain fart. Okay. I punched out an expense report before I hopped on this sucker, and my brain hasn't shifted gears yet. Yes, a dress rehearsal.
No work.
work. Okay.
Everybody has to take a drink. We talked about work.
Oh gosh. I wish I had alcohol in my house, because I would.
Speaking of losing my mind, I would be like, what? Climbing the walls. But yeah, so I think that was my like secret favorite part, was like all of the dress rehearsals and all the dance routines that they did. And I love that one ditzy blonde. They kept trying to like pawn off on everybody. And like, I loved that about her, like the thirsty girl. I just love the costume. So for me personally,
it's so funny how they hated women back then.
What?
That's
so great how they hated women back then. It's like White Christmas was one of the few movies back then where a woman didn't get slapped in the face.
Nobody threatens you.
Girl, no.
Ba-da-ba-ba-da-ba. No. Okay.
This is one of the this is one of those movies that I never want to see remade. Like, it's
no,
perfect.
Please don't. Please.
Never remake it. Just
okay. Grace, go tell your generation we don't need it. Because White Men Can't Jump got remade, and we didn't need that.
Mm-mm. Sure didn't.
Who asked Jack Harlow?
Yeah, who asked for that? I would like to know.
How young I am, I thought that was an original movie. I watched it, and I was like, this is weird. I did not know it was a remake.
I mean, if you watch the original, you might understand what the movie was actually supposed to be.
That's fair. I thought it was just one big ad for Jack Harlow.
It is.
Which is what it was. That's
under
what it
the
was.
Premise of a movie that was better in the 80s, late, early That's 90s.
Fair. Yeah.
That's fair. I think they're trying to make him the next Mac Miller. Like, everything they're doing right now feels like PR. But anyways.
I just want you to know that that movie took Woody Harrelson out of Cheers world and brought him into, like, mainstream and gave him his official sex appeal. That movie.
I mean, he never had Woody Harrelson sex appeal. Where?
Oh my God, girl, absolutely. Where? Girl, all day.
Standing next to Wesley Snipes? Are you serious?
I'm not saying Wesley Snipes was Woody like Harrelson. That. No, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about a bald white man, okay? Woody Harrelson's up there.
No, he was never.
Next to who?
That's what I'm saying. Bruce now Willis, girl, he can never see Bruce Willis. He can never. Oh my God. He can't sniff Bruce Willis' draw.
I feel like we talked about this because Bruce Willis is my main. He's my main bald white man crush.
Woody Harrelson. Woody Harrelson is a weirdo, and he's always been a weirdo.
Woody Harrelson, I feel like, doesn't belong in, like, the bald white man category, though. He belongs in, like, the weirdly strung out, belongs at a gas station category. Like,
he's the Randy Quaid category. Yeah, he's Randy Quaid.
No.
And, yeah, and or, like, Matthew McConaughey, like, they seem like weird uncle and nephew to me.
Oh, I see what you're saying. That might stink when you meet them, but you're not sure what you're going to get.
Yeah. Yeah, you're like, I don't know why I find you attractive, but I do.
Matthew
McConaughey is a beautiful man. Matthew McConaughey is a beautiful man.
Yeah, he is a beautiful man. Okay.
And that voice, oh my God.
Oh my God. Oh my goodness.
That's a beautiful
voice. I would make it. He's a professor. He teaches a class at UT. I would flunk out. I wouldn't even know what he was talking about.
Yeah. I would just be watching him walk back and forth.
Yeah, and I'd probably fall asleep to his voice, his velvety voice.
So what was that? Lay on your lap as you teach? Thanks.
Just keep talking. Don't mind me, students. I'm just a woman who's wandered in off the street to lay on Matthew McConaughey's lap.
While he speaks and strokes my hair.
Matthew, tell security to stand down. So, okay, fine. So then who? I mean, Woody Harrelson.
I mean, I don't think we're going to get a remake of White Christmas, because they tried to redo, like, they tried to bring back musicals for a second in, like, 2016. And it didn't happen. They tried.
La La Land ruffled some feathers. I'm just going to say.
Yeah. Because that was like the golden age.
Yeah.
That's the golden age of cinema. Like, you can't recreate that.
No.
It was a beautiful white time in American cinema. And we will leave it as it was.
You know what? Actually, I'm going to say something very controversial.
Do it. Do it hard.
These dance musicals have been recreated, at least the choreography, in Beyonce videos.
I mean, she was into the Fosse.
She loves a Fosse.
You'll do a Fosse, girl.
Which y'all think the Single Ladies was? Bob Fosse. And that dance routine specifically came from the movie Sweet Charity with Shirley MacLaine.
There you go.
Don't get me started. I actually do love old movies. I actually do. And
well, you know, like old movies of that time, like part, it is very much like a gilded age. It just exists in this. It exists in like this kind of, right. It does. It's like very pristine. And even as racist as it was, it's like you can't help but admire it.
I know. Because they had talent, but they were also trained, like, trained performers.
When the PR was on lock. The PR, because nobody had cell phones, nobody was tweeting things, there was no paparazzi, that didn't exist. You had photographers at events, but you could still, like, go get milk, and it wasn't a big deal.
Yeah, you could slap your husband with your glove and nobody would see it.
Nobody cared.
Right, nobody knew how racist John Wayne was. Nobody knew that Ben Crosby was beating his kids. because they were movie men and they were great.
I didn't know Bing Crosby was beating his kids.
Yeah. I don't even think they were his biological children. I think he adopted a bunch of kids. That's what I think. I feel like I remember just hearing that. Hang on, let me double check that. Lucille Ball, y'all remember from I Love Lucy?
Of course.
Wrote her autobiography and had it in her will that it couldn't be published till after she died. And it's like a Hollywood tell-all.
Wait,
like,
what book like, is this?
And this person tried to kill themselves and da-da-da-da-da. It's like
what book
it's
is this?
In depth. It's called Love, Lucy. It's Lucille Ball's autobiography. It's juicy.
Ooh.
It is juicy.
Well, let me finish my Britney Spears Woman in Me, and then I'm next. And then that's next. She's trying. I think that's what this is modeled after, to be honest. The Britney Spears book, I feel like, is modeled after that because she's spilling tea on a few people.
I haven't read it, but I after like it came out and you know Newsweek and all these publications were covering the like highlights of the book. So I was telling my boyfriend Wally, you've met Wally. I was telling him about it, and I was like, "Oh, they did this to her, and they did that. It's terrible," and blah blah blah. And he's not saying much. And then I get to the part where she basically says Justin Timberlake has a micro penis. And he goes, "Oh my God, that's terrible." That was what woke him up.
He was like, "What?"
Now, why she had to go for Justin like that? We didn't have to know about his tiny, tiny penis.
I mean,
we didn't,
bringing sexy
we didn't need to know that at all.
Bringing sexy back, you know. I haven't finished it, and by the way, I'm not reading it. I'm listening to it on long drives. And Michelle Williams does a, who I feel like Michelle Williams was transported from the very era that we're referencing right now. Like, I didn't, no shade, but I didn't think much of her in Dawson's Creek. But the Michelle Williams that we see today, I'm just kind of like, whew. She does a beautiful job with the audible. And she, Britney Spears literally speaks for the first 90 seconds of the book. And you, right when your mind says, "I don't know if I'm going to get through this listening to her voice sounding like this."
Girl, goes, like how could
and
you?
I'm only reading this part. Bye. And I was like, whoa.
Hey, y'all, it's Britney Spears. Like, girl, I don't want to hear you talk no more.
Hey, y'all, it's Britney. And I just want y'all to know that parts of this book is very traumatic. And so, therefore, I won't be reading the entirety of this book. It will be read by the illustrious Michelle Williams. Thank you so much for your interest in my life and my journey. And I hope that you enjoy this book. Something to that of that measure. And then here comes Michelle. It was a warm Louisiana night, and I'm like, oh yeah, tuck me in, give me my warm milk, let's do this. And then she does like different like accents, and she it's just, anyways, I love it. So I bet I haven't finished it because I haven't been driving long enough to listen. Let's get to the scores. Boop. All right.
Yeah.
All right, so hot cocos, how many do you get? I have all sorts of props back here you don't want to see. Let's start with Grace, since it was your recommendation. Tell me, how many hot peppermint hot chocolates do you give White Christmas, the classic?
So I'm going to break it down and then give you my overall, and you can edit out the fluff if you want to.
That's fine.
If we're talking about story, it's like a two. If we're talking about continuity, it's like a two. But if we're talking about costumes, if we're talking about casting, the casting, you can't remake it because you can't get that cast again. It's theirs. Casting, backdrops, music, timing, sequences, bumps this way back up. Then you add the sprinkle of nostalgia. Reminds me was when I was in my little homeschool cult. I'm going to give it 4.5.
Okay. A 4.5.
Can I do halves?
Yeah. I've done a 0.75 before because I was feeling reckless.
Well,
math sorts it all out, so it's fine. So you said a 4.5, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. What say you, DDT?
Well, I do agree with Grace. Just the pageantry of it all, the Hollywood glamour of it all, the musical numbers, mm-hmm. the clothes, you know, just the artistry of it, the professionalism, you know, that bumps it up real high. Also, one of my favorite parts of the movie is just that everybody on the movie looks like they're having a great time making it. I don't know what was going on behind the scenes, but they look like they were having the time of their lives just making this movie.
Yeah.
And I love to see that. But the absence of Negroes, hard deduction. So, I mean, and it tugged on the heartstrings a little bit. I feel like it glamorized World War II a little bit, but every movie did back then. So I guess I can't really knock it for that.
No.
So I'm going to have to give it a hard 4.
Okay.
I would like, I'm almost at a 3.5 for the dearth of Negroes, but.
May I ask a question about the score that you're giving? Can I ask about that? In the absence of Negroes, African-Americans, Black actors, because they were around at that time.
Yes, they were.
Would it have mattered their role in the film? Or did you just want to see like a handyman or a butler? Because that's likely what we would have gotten. Or even just a soldier who happened to be one of their good friends in the army.
Exactly. Like a dude like that. Like, you know, you put a Pearl Bailey in there. Put a Sydney. Put a Harry Belafonte. Somebody, girl.
Somebody. I feel like Harry would have got cast.
You know, just to be one of the homeboys. Just to be like, hey, this is our dude. You know, shut up.
It's our musical director, Harry Belafonte.
What? Well, you got Harry Belafonte, and then I feel like another option they could have gone with, and they could have got twins out of it.
Sidney Poitier. Or was he too young at the time?
No, I think that's about both of they started. They were contemporaries, I think. Let's see. Harry Belafonte.
They could have got, oh God.
So yeah, he started in the 50s. That's when he was doing calypso singing stuff. But Sammy Davis Jr., Sammy Davis could have been in there doing it. Because
he and Crosby were in the Rat Pack anyway.
They could have had the Nicholas brothers.
That's what I was about to say, the Nicholas brothers too. They were some singing, dancing people.
You know.
Pearl Bailey. Somebody, girl.
If it was too much of a stretch, just drop a Lena Horne in there. They don't
know. Lena's always good for something. Eartha was always good for it.
Eartha was really good.
So yeah, they had a lot of people that they could have sprinkled in there, but of course they never did because for them, in those days, Black people didn't exist. And I guess thanks to good old segregation, that's fair. But yeah, and you know, that whole, like I said, that era exists in a bubble where you can almost forgive the blatant racism because it was just so beautiful and fun and glamorous.
Yeah.
And we had our own films, you know, we had Oregon Best, I guess, girl. I don't know. But Black people didn't have Christmas back then. We couldn't have no Christmas. I don't know about no Black people Christmas.
And this is why I don't care. This little mug, he looks.
He looks like he's acute. It's accusatory. He looked like like he's looking back at Christmas past. Like, yeah, we were there too.
But it's a Black Santa, and damn it, he got purchased at the at-home store. At-home store went wild. With inclusivity this Christmas, at home store went wild. I even have a Black nutcracker. I've never had a black nutcracker. I have a gingerbread wreath hanging in my office right now because I thought it was a little Black girl on there. No, she's a gingerbread girl. I'll take her anyway.
And they got like Black happy holidays, Black Lives Matter. Do they have like a BLM wreath?
I mean, you can make
some black red and green garlands. I don't know.
I feel like sure.
I think they pour it on a bit thick. In retail, but you know, like I said, in those times, it's easy to kind of overlook it because that's just what movies were.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is why I didn't take them down to a 3.5. Gonna stay at a hard 4. Also, Danny Kaye,
he brought us back up. So, Danny brought us back up.
So 4. It has to be a 4.
Okay.
Oh, and nostalgic. It reminds me of my mama. Like, I can't look at that movie without thinking about my mama. So.
Yes. Okay. Okay. So then with that, I will say costumes for me, 5. 5s across the board for the costumes, hair, makeup. I mean, even the little dance routines where at one point Miss Clooney got a little groove to her, or maybe it was the other one. She tried to groove it out a little bit when she did the
little salsa, like
There was like a moment. I like the characters. I do agree that the plot was a little like linear, just like boop boop beep 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 bop. Like it just was, but I mean that's what it was for. It wasn't meant to be like, you know, a mind-bending thrill ride like every movie is today. I love the fact that the songs in the movie are classic now, like Christmas classics. You don't even have to know all the words, and they weren't like lyric heavy anyway. You just got, you know, snow. You're like, oh, snow.
No.
Okay. I want to wash my hair and something, something in snow. And I was like, oh, that's a nice dream.
Okay.
See, that's maybe cute. You couldn't have Black people in the movie. If you talk about washing your hair and snow, no. Immediately we're out. Don't get us wet. Please don't.
So please don't throw no snowball at my head because we're going to fight.
We're going to fight. Okay. All body shots. and then, yeah, I think nostalgia for sure. I don't remember where I first saw it. I want to guess maybe school. Maybe I saw it at school. And I don't know. The cast, amazing. So, yeah, I'm going to give it a 4 as well. I just think it's like the backdrop of the Christmas holidays. Like, it's just there. And of all of the old movies that have started to resurface and TikTok has begun to break them down, this has the least amount of, like, offensive Easter eggs in it from what I saw. Like, I didn't catch a flare. I didn't hear, like, a passing N-word. I didn't hear none of that. So,
right.
You know, so anyway, I mean, for that, because some of these movies, when you watch them back, you know, you're like, they say that? Oh my gosh. This was, to your point earlier, Grace, no women were threatened to be hit or were actually hit, or maybe that was Dee Dee. I don't remember which one of you.
Okay. That was one moment, but not to her face. He just says he would do it if he found her. When they have the whole tickets discrepancy on the train, and he finds out that Danny Kaye gave their club tickets, or the drawing room tickets or whatever, the girls. And he says, I'm opening that door. And if I see the Hayes sisters, I'm grabbing them both by their hair.
I heard that.
Yeah. And then the girls walk up and he's like, oh.
So he gets cut off before he even can make good on, like, even finish what his threat is.
Yeah, he just says, I'm going to grab them by the hair. And they cut it off. They're like, that's enough.
See? You see? In the 50s, all right, you really can't escape
it. See? Boom. Okay. So a 4.5. Let me get out my Texas Instruments calculator to make sure that this is proper scoring. If we take the 2 and carry the 1.
Looks like 4.23333.
Hold on. I have production helping me with the calculations. 1 second, DDT. We've got a 4.16666667. So
I overshot it a little bit.
Yeah, no, you're good. 4.2 is what we'll say, which makes it a 4 if we're talking, if we're really just dealing in the real world. It's a 4. So we give White Christmas a score of 4 peppermint hot chocolates. Yay!
Right, because whoever heard of 0.16 of a hot chocolate? No one.
Yeah. No one. No one that loved life at all or enjoyed a tasty beverage with hot chocolate in it. All right. Well, this concludes episode 4-ish, of Haute Cocoa Critics. Thank you so much, Grace. Thank you so much, DDT, for joining me tonight. It has been a pleasure. And have a happy holiday. Yay!